Hello everyone, welcome to my session. Today I'm gonna talk about PostgreSQL on Kubernetes and explain how we run it at Zalando for more than 2 years in production. First of all, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Alexander Kukushkin and I work as database engineer for Zalando. People in the Postgres community know me as the Patroni guy, because I'm maintainer and major contributor to the Patroni project, which implements PostgreSQL high availability. Agenda of today's talk. First, I will give some brief introduction to Kubernetes, then I will explain how we use Pila and Patroni in order to deploy and run highly available Postgres clusters on Kubernetes. After that, I will explain how Zalando Postgres operator helping us to do high-level orchestration of such deployments. And finally, I will go through the list of typical problems and horror stories we hit by running a few hundred production deployments. So, what Kubernetes is? Kubernetes is a container orchestration system. It is built as a set of open source components which are running on one or more physical servers. The physical server could be the hypervisor which you typically get from your cloud provider, and probably most of Kubernetes deployments are done on top of cloud infrastructure, not on the physical hardware. Kubernetes implements idea of infrastructure as a code. It means that you describe all your infrastructure as a set of manifests files which you keep in your source control system. In case if your application is able to scale, you can configure Kubernetes to run more or less application instances depending on the incoming load and depending on how your hardware is utilized. It is able to either allocate new instances from your cloud provider or shut down the running instances. One may think about Kubernetes as a next logical step to automate infrastructure after you already used Ansible, Chef or Puppet. Probably I should also tell a few words what Kubernetes is not. Kubernetes is not an operating system. You cannot just install Kubernetes on top of physical hardware. In fact, Kubernetes is running on top of Linux system. In case if your application is not able to scale, Kubernetes will not automatically make it scalable. You still have to invest into making your application scalable and supporting running multiple copies of it. If you think that after migrating all your infrastructure to Kubernetes, you can fire your DevOps or system engineers, you are totally wrong, because Kubernetes is a very complex system with a lot of layers of abstraction, and it's always a good idea to have somebody who understands how it works and is able to debug all problems on every level of Kubernetes. And if you run only 2, 3, or maybe up to 10 servers, probably Kubernetes is not something what you should be looking for. It's possible to manage such number of resources manually without big issues. If you take a high-level overview on Kubernetes, there are different types of nodes. There are master nodes. And the main component on the master node is a Kubernetes API service. And master node also is taking care about scheduling the pods where your application is running on the worker nodes. Optionally, it could be running etcd on the master nodes, but it's also possible, like we do, to run etcd separately. And for high availability, you need to run more than one master node at a time, or at least in case if you doing Kubernetes upgrade, you need first to start the new master node and only after that stop the old one. So how we run Kubernetes at Zalando? We have not just a single Kubernetes cluster, but in fact we have more than 140 Kubernetes clusters. Not all of them are production, it's 50-50 distribution between production and test systems. Deployment to production cluster supposed to happen only via CI/CD pipeline, except maybe a few exceptions, like exception if there is an incident in progress, or like in case if you want to debug some very strange issue in production. In this case, you need to request explicitly the access, and such access either requires incident ticket to be opened, or your access request must be approved by one of your colleagues. So how to run stateful applications on Kubernetes? When Kubernetes and Docker were just emerging a few years ago, they didn't really have good stories for running stateful workloads. Luckily for us, situation has changed, and right now we have two very nice abstractions, two very nice components in the Kubernetes, which allowing us to run stateful applications. One of such components, it's persistent volumes. What does it mean? Like you can use with the with the help of some storage plugin, you can allocate persistent volume from the external system. Like in the cloud provider, you typically use EBS on AWS or maybe Azure Disk if you run on Microsoft Azure. And if you run in the data center, there are options available like iSCSI, NAS, SAN, NFS, and so on. And the second very important component, it's a stateful set. It allows us to run the fixed number of application instances or pods in the Kubernetes world. And those pods will have stable and unique identifier. And the second very important property of stateful set, that it is able to take care about volume allocation for you. And every pod in the stateful set will get the unique volume which is allocated for this pod, and in case if pod is migrated between Kubernetes nodes, the persistent volume will be attached to the new node and pod will get data back. So it's essential for stateful application to keep a state somewhere on disk or on external volume. And stateful set abstraction is really handy to solve such issue. In order to run application on Kubernetes, we need some container. Typically, people using Docker containers, like in most cases, although there are different possibilities. And we run Docker and we have the Docker image, which we name Spilo. The Spilo, by the way, is an elephant in Georgian. In the single Docker image, we package all supported PostgreSQL versions. Nowadays, it's starting from 9.5 and up to version 12. On top of that, we have plenty of useful Postgres extensions, which are not part of Postgres core. We also have some tools for PGQ for backup recovery, like WallG and PGBouncer. Of course, we keep PGData on external volume because in case container if restarted, like all data is gone, and on external volume we can persist it. And for high availability, we are using Patroni. As it is common, we are relying on the environment variables for configuration our Docker container. So what Patroni is? Patroni is automatic failover solution for Postgres. It is implemented in Python, and one Patroni Python daemon is managing a single PostgreSQL instance. What PostgreSQL instance is? PostgreSQL instance, it's one of instance of a PostgreSQL cluster. It's either primary or one of the replicas. And Patroni supposed to be running on all of such instances. Patroni is able to use Kubernetes API service in order to do leader race. And basically Patroni makes PostgreSQL the first class citizen on Kubernetes. It's possible to deploy Postgres on Kubernetes without any external dependencies. Like etcd with the help of Patroni, and Patroni will take care about a lot of stuff. It's possible to deploy the new cluster easily. It means that one of the nodes will run NITDB and other nodes will take base backup from the initialized node. Patroni has a good story for scaling in and scaling out, and Patroni also helps a lot to manage PostgreSQL configuration. Like, for example, it takes care about keeping max connections in sync between all members of PostgreSQL cluster. How to deploy it on Kubernetes? Like, we create the stateful set object, which will create pods across multiple nodes and provision persistent volumes. One of the nodes will become the primary, like on this picture, it is marked as a role master, and other nodes will be running as replicas. Patroni is using, in this case, the leader endpoint for leader election, and the same endpoint is telling the leader service how to access the master pod. It's all also optionally able to. It's also possibly optionally to create the replica service, which will do the load balancing, read-only load balancing across pods which are running as replicas. The master node, with the help of Wally, is doing backups and continuous archiving of write-ahead logs to S3 storage on AWS, and replica pods in case if they need some wall files, they can get them from S3. But usually replica pods are just using streaming replication in order to get write-ahead logs from the primary. So how to deploy it? Like, of course, you have to write a lot of YAML, 100 slides of lines of code. And after that, you can easily deploy the single manifest and get all these objects ready, and you get your PostgreSQL highly available clusters cluster up and running on Kubernetes. But after that, there are a few problems which needs to be solved. Like, one of such problems is like reconfiguration of the cluster or performing the rolling upgrade. Rolling upgrade could be due to change of Docker image with the Postgres in order to perform the minor upgrade, or it could be the Kubernetes rolling upgrade itself, because Kubernetes major version upgrade requires rotating of all worker nodes. And in case if you're unlucky, we can get into a very strange situation. Like, let's take a look how this Kubernetes rolling upgrade works. First, like we got into a situation that there are three nodes which must be upgraded. And on these three nodes, distributed across three different availability zones, there are three Postgres clusters are running. And as a first step, Kubernetes will terminate the first node to be upgraded. And of course, Patroni will do a failover, and primary will move to another node which was previously a replica. After that, like, of course, we get some termination connections, termination of connections, application connections. They will have to reconnect, and there will be some unhappy people which are relying on this application, but it usually doesn't take long time, just a couple of seconds. Not nice. But Kubernetes does a job. It will reschedule pods which were running on node which was terminated on the new node, and will continue with rolling upgrade. As the next step, it will terminate the second node. And we again got some failovers. And again some connection interruptions. And people are getting a bit more upset and unhappy. Kubernetes, of course, reschedules pods from one node which was terminated on the new node. It gets persistent volume attached, and replicas will finally start streaming from new primaries. But take a look, like, we got all new primaries at the moment which are again running on the node which is supposed to be terminated. And Kubernetes terminated the last node, worker node for major upgrade, and we again got some failovers. And like, if you didn't count it, how many failovers has happened for every cluster A, B, and C, I did it for you. And like, for cluster A, we got three failovers, and for clusters B and C, we got two failovers. Three, it's a very unlucky case, because like, for the cluster with three pods, we can experience up to 3 failovers during such major rolling upgrade. And on average, for a cluster of 3 pods, you will get 2 failovers. And if you are very lucky, you will get only 1 failover. This is something what should be improved. We can improve it with high-level orchestration. So before we start implementing something, let's take a look how the PostgreSQL cluster lifecycle looks like. It's not only about Kubernetes, it's about any PostgreSQL deployment. First, you prepare some configuration, you create some Postgres cluster, and deploy this by deploying the configuration. After that, you connect to the cluster, you create some databases, create user, and so on and so forth. It will be running for a while until you decide to change something. Therefore, you update cluster configuration, you redeploy it, and perform some actions like rolling restarts of Postgres, or like rolling upgrade with switchover, or something like this. And like these three actions will be continuing doing in the loop for a while. Like it might be a few months or a few years until you decide to decommission your cluster finally. And you would like to automate absolutely everything. You would like to automate deployments of a new cluster. We would like to automate all upgrades and user management, configuration management, and of course, like whenever we do this cluster configuration, the number of interruptions or failovers must be minimized. And in order to do so, we built Zalando Postgres operator. So if you are not familiar with operator pattern, the idea is that operator, it's a application which acts like a human and on behalf of the human, and it implements all human knowledge of operating certain resource like PostgreSQL cluster. Like if you are a human, you can know how to do something with minimal impact. And like in order to do it such operation at scale, we can implement the software which will do it for us. And Kubernetes is very extensible system. Like what you can use not only existing Kubernetes objects or Kubernetes abstraction, but you can define your own Kubernetes resources. And Postgres operator defines custom PostgreSQL resource. And it's possible to create instances of such resource, which will be representing your PostgreSQL clusters. And depending on event what happens, like either the new resource was created or existing resource was updated or deleted, Postgres operator acts upon such events and changing corresponding Kubernetes objects. And in case if there is some ongoing maintenance happening, operator also could help with it. Basically, how the such PostgreSQL manifest look like? It's a very short YAML file. There are a few essential variables which you have to fill up, like the cluster name. It's important because it must be unique across the whole Kubernetes cluster within the same namespace. You need to define how big should be the volume for your data, how many pods you would like to run within your stateful set, and what PostgreSQL version you need. Optionally, you can define the memory and CPU requests and limits, and like users or databases which you would like to create. If you didn't fill it up, it's fine. Operator will either use some defaults or will not create databases and users for you. But creation of such users is very handy because operator will not only create the user in the database, it will also create the secret object. So how does it look like on the high level? We got the operator pod running, and it defines the custom resource, PostgreSQL resource, and HappyDB deployer, which could be either the human user or it could be CI/CD pipeline, creates the new cluster manifest. And Postgres operator starts acting upon it. It will create cluster secrets, which will contain the usernames and password for PostgreSQL super user and PostgreSQL replication user. Optionally, it could also create cluster secrets for a client application, which will just use them seamlessly. Also, operator will create the service and endpoint, and it will, like, in order to access the PostgreSQL cluster. And of course, it will create the stateful set with fixed number of pods. Stateful set will take care about provisioning persistent volumes. How operator helps us to solve the rolling upgrade problem, well, like Kubernetes rolling upgrade? We again got into the situation where there are three nodes to be upgraded, distributed across different availability zones, and there are three nodes which were spinned up for replacement. And operator does it smart. It can detect that there are some pods running on the node which to be decommissioned, and before actually doing something, it will first terminate replica pods which are running on such nodes in order to migrate them to the new nodes. And basically we got already replicas running on the nodes which already migrated, so upgraded on the new nodes. And after that, operator will do the switchover, control switchover, and Postgres Patron will shut down Postgres gracefully and remove the leader key by telling replicas that you are good to go to start a leader race. And after that, we get replicas running on the new nodes, and the former primaries will be still running at this moment on the nodes which are not yet upgraded, but operator will also terminate them, and Kubernetes will reschedule such pods on the new nodes, and everything is fine. So we got only one failover for every cluster. And just try to think about a case when you have a few dozen of nodes and a few hundred of PostgreSQL clusters running on Kubernetes. Like, none of the humans could do such smart moves in order to minimize number of switchover. And but machine can, like application code, and Postgres operator really helps us a lot to minimize the number of failovers and solve such problem. Since we run our deployments on AWS, we got some issues with AWS infrastructure. Like, if you are not familiar with AWS API, it supports the, like, whatever you do with your deployments, with your Kubernetes, and if it interacts with AWS infrastructure, it will call the AWS API to do something. And in case if you run many nodes and many volumes and so on, the number of API requests to AWS infrastructure will be relatively high, and you might start experiencing the AWS API rate limit exceeded errors. It's not nice because it delays deployment of new clusters, like it's not able to provision persistent volumes, and some rolling upgrades of existing clusters also are delayed because it cannot attach or reattach persistent volumes to the new node. But we can live with it. Some bigger issues are coming from EC2 instances which are running on the failed hardware. AWS is doing actually pretty good job by detecting such failed hardware, and they're terminating such instances gracefully. But such instance shutdown might take ages, and unfortunately we never probably seen that it takes less than 30 minutes to complete. And all EBS volumes which are attached to such failed instance could not be reused, and it's not possible to attach it to another instance, and therefore, like all Postgres clusters which we are running on this instance will be like in the little bit degraded state. Of course, like if you run more than one pod, you will have still the primary running, but there will be no, like, either not enough replicas or just no replicas at all. And Since we always monitor such situation, we get paged due to such issues, and especially it's unpleasant if you get paged at night. Of course, the disk space is not really related to Kubernetes, but since we run a few hundred of PostgreSQL clusters, from time to time we have such issues. Like application might write quite a few data just in the limited time frame, and in the Kubernetes world, and especially like in the cloud infrastructure world, it's very common nowadays to use just a single instance, single volume for PG data, PG wall, and PG logs. Why it's a quite a common practice? Because you are paying per gigabyte of the volume, and your performance of the volume depends on this volume size. Basically, provisioning two separate volumes could become very expensive, and therefore people prefer just using the single volume. And like when Postgres trying to write something and it cannot, so it gets the error not space left on device and shuts himself down. Patroni does a pretty good job. It detects that Postgres is not running and starts it up in recovery, does a promote, and Postgres apparently after promote again starts writing some data on disk, again get no space left error and shuts it down. And such a crash recovery loop could continue forever until Postgres will not be able to start at all. So the only solution to such problem is monitoring disk space and do like preventing disk space to going down to absolutely zero. Since we are running in the cloud, we always have the option to implement ftextend. So far we didn't done it. So why? I will tell why. Because we did some analysis of why the disk space was used so heavily, and out of so different many cases, there is just a single one which might probably require ftextend. When your data is growing naturally and like the cleanup jobs are already configured, and there is no possibility to actually to free up the space anymore. And it's very easy to extend the volume in the cloud, but it's not so easy to shrink it back. And the only way to do so is removing the existing volume and creating the new one, which is smaller. And of course, it will require you to copy the whole data, like whole PG data directory, which takes time. Another interesting issue. It's maybe again not really related to Kubernetes, but it is still very funny. We have the monitoring for like backups, and like we want to make sure that every cluster gets the base backup every night. And sometimes for clusters we notice that backup is missing. We start investigating what is wrong, and we see that Wally was failing with the error message that there is a file which is bigger than expected Postgres data file, and Postgres data file usually does not exceed 1 gigabyte, and the threshold in the Wally was 1.5 gigabytes, and there was apparently a file which is even bigger, and it was nearly 2 gigabytes in size. And this file was pgstat statements. Surprise! Like when we started investigating why it is so huge, why it is so bloated, we did a select from pgstat statements, and we found a lot of similar queries, like with a very little fraction of differences. Like mostly these queries are generated by ORMs, and they could really make the pgstat statements very bloated. And the other issue of bloated pgstat statements that it's not only taking space on disk, but like if you're trying to query it, like your Postgres backend process will use more than work mem. Like in this case, Postgres backend will become 2 gigabytes in size because it will have to read the whole pgstat statements from the disk into a memory. And another issue with Wally. Wally, unfortunately, is a very old backup tool. It's relying on exclusive backups, and therefore, like all exclusive backup issues, not coming for free. Like what exclusive backup? When it started, it creates a backup label in the PG data. And in case if such pod was terminated and you are trying to start the Postgres back, it will find that there is a backup label in data directory. It will think that it's, oh, something is strange, like online backup was canceled, and after such attempt to start it up, like you will not be able to start such Postgres at all in the future. And the only way to bring such replica back, like the former master back is a replica, it's rebuilding it, reinitializing. There are backup tools which are doing better job. They implement non-exclusive backups like PG, like Rep Manager, like PG Backrest and Volgy. Unfortunately, PG Backrest is not an option for us because we target to support multiple different clouds and people. But PG Backrest so far supports only S3 storage. With Volgy, like it supports all cloud providers as a Wally, but every time when I'm trying to use it in production, I find some new issues with Volgy, therefore I'm a bit scared. So far we're using Volgy only for restoring backups and write-ahead logs, but we are taking backups still with Wally. Yet another issue, it's out of memory killer. It could happen that Postgres process was terminated with signal 9. Like we all know that we should not kill Postgres processes with seek kill, and we know for sure that it wasn't a human who did this. And when we start investigating, like you run dmessage, and in order to get the system log from the container, and you see yes, the Postgres process was killed with by the C group due to out of memory, but the process ID in the container and the process ID on the host are different. Therefore, it's not always possible or easy to draw the line between those events. Sometimes people are using ohm score adjust trick in order to avoid Postgres being killed by out of memory killer. In the container world, it's not possible, I would say, because we have only Postgres and Patroni running, and it will still kill someone. The question is either Patroni or Postgres. And it wasn't very clear how the memory accounting works, like how the Postgres process managed to get for nearly 6 GB of memory usage out of 8 GB. Okay, 2 GB are used by shared buffers, but where this other 4 GB are coming from? And it was puzzling us for quite a long time. And there is also a different out of memory flavor. It wasn't Postgres which was killed, but we noticed that sometimes pod have the high number of restarts, which sometimes happens due to restart of the node, but and therefore pod will be restarted. But in this case, it wasn't the node restart because node uptime was still high a few days, and we started looking into pod events, and there is a message something like sandbox changed, and therefore pod will be recreated and killed. We again go into the container by doing kubectl exec. We run dmessage and we see more or less the same picture, out of memory killer, but somehow scores for every process in the container are absolutely the same, and the score is like has a very strange number, minus 998. Why this number looks like this? It's because the memory request and memory limit are specified exactly to the same values. Therefore, like Kubernetes is using the special treatment for such containers. It like uses the quality of service which is guaranteed. And The C group interface cannot do anything good except killing maybe one of such process in the container randomly. And it turned out to be that the pulse process was unlucky to be killed. So how we mitigated out of memory killer? First, like we tried to reduce shared buffers, like from 25% to 20%. It helped a bit, but not 100%. But what apparently was the issue is that when Postgres is writing something to disk, it generates a lot of dirty buffers in the virtual memory of the Linux kernel. And by default, such dirty pages are limited by 10% of available memory on the node. Like in case if you have 32 gigabytes of memory on the node, you may write up to 3 gigabytes of dirty buffers, more or less. And if your container configured to be smaller than 3 gigabyte, basically you can run into out of memory without doing memory allocation resources. Unfortunately, it's not possible to set dirty background bytes and dirty bytes for per pod or per container. It could be set only per node. So did we, and it solved most of our issues. One more problem from Kubernetes, and like more probably it's more from the Docker. Sometimes like we get requests from our employees, from our colleagues, that oh, the Postgres processes are getting some strange errors, Postgres connections getting some strange errors, no space left on device, but there is plenty of space on data partition. When we start looking on it closely, we see that it could not resize shared memory. Therefore, it's not data device is a culprit, but DevSham. And in the Docker, DevSham by default is only 64 megabytes. It's possible to change in the Docker by specifying the special command line argument. This limit, but for Kubernetes the only way to fix it is a mounting a dedicated device to DevSham. So we did it in Postgres operator, and so far the problem also has gone. Human errors, like because cluster manifests are created by humans, sometimes they are doing a bit mad things. They might specify resource requests and limits absolutely inadequate. Either pod cannot be scheduled because all nodes are much smaller than you request resources for your pod, or another issue, people are so greedy, they would like to save money and specify very little CPU and memory request, and therefore container is killed by OM killer before it actually managed to do something. A couple of times we've seen that service account used by Postgres operator Spila and Patronym were deleted by employees. In one case it was deleted by mistake, and in another case the employee just wanted to see what will happen if he will remove the service account. And the service account is used, it contains credentials to access Kubernetes REST API service. And in case if there is no valid credentials, Kubernetes API service could not be accessed, and Patroni cannot update the leader key, and therefore it restarts Postgres read-only. It took some time to figure out how to better fix such situation, but we managed to do it with minor impact. And last but not least, it's a YAML formatting. YAML supposed to be the human readable and human writable, but in fact it's neither one of those. Even with such a small YAML manifest, people like could very easy to misformat it, and therefore we had to came up with a web UI where you fill up cluster name and choose from the drop down list like a few other arguments how this cluster should be generated. As a result, we generate the YAML definition file, and which you can copy into your clipboard, write into file system, and apply to Kubernetes. It also solves quite a few problems. So Coming to conclusion, coming to the end, Postgres operator helps us to manage more than 1500 production PostgreSQL clusters deployed across 80 Kubernetes clusters on AWS. And without such high level of automation, it wouldn't be possible. Just imagine, like, managing manually so many highly available clusters. And in the cloud, and especially on Kubernetes, due to multi-layered infrastructure, you have to prepare to deal with absolutely new problems and failure scenarios. You have to invest a lot into yourself and to learn all these infrastructure issues and how to solve them. You need to always find the solution and implement a permanent fix, otherwise the problem will always come back. And of course, everything I have been talking about, it's open source projects, Postgres Operator, Patronium, Spila. It is hosted at Zalando GitHub organization. You can try to run it on your laptop. And in case of any issues, feel free to open the GitHub issue or a pull request. What is better, which is fixing this issue. So thank you very much for attention. And in case if you have some questions, I'm ready to answer.
We're back now with a Q&A with Alexander. Go ahead, please.
So, hi. So I hope you enjoy my presentation, and I've got the following questions. And like, I will start from the first one, which is from Pasha Golub. Right now, most of the configuration changes, even PGHBA causes rolling update when pods are restarted. Do you have plans to patch this behavior? If no, do you need any help with this? Yes, like, I don't like such behavior either. And we certainly have some plans to improve on that. And in case if you are willing to help, all contributions are always welcome. The second question. Upgrading through replica, does it mean the data is duplicated? I don't really follow what is this question about. Since we are relying on streaming replication in Postgres, we have data duplicated, sort like Postgres data duplicated between masters and replicas always. And I don't know what to add. And one more question. Do you have any, that was question from Gelindir, if I can spell it correctly. Do you have any load balancer like PG pool in front of your replicas, or do clients connect directly to Postgres pods? We don't have any magical load balancer like PG pool, which does split between read and read write queries. Clients connect either to the primary load balancer, like a primary service in Kubernetes, or they connect to the replica service, which does load balancing across multiple pods. So it's also a single endpoint for client connections, and it takes care about connecting you to the pod which is running the replica. And regarding load balancer, recently we did a release, and it's now possible to deploy the set of PG balancers in front of primary service. And there is a separate Kubernetes service for primary PG balancers. And you can have three different services and you can choose between them. Like either you can connect to the primary via load balancer, or you can connect to the primary via PG balancer, or you can connect to the replica via replica service. And in future, it will be possible also to connect to the replicas via load balancer, like PG balancer, for example. And the last question from Stevenson. You talk about 10% dirty buffer limit. that is set on the node level. That property, what property controls that? Is it a kernel setting or kernel or Docker Kubernetes setting? Since Kubernetes is running on Linux, it's a typical Linux setting. It's a VM dirty background ratio and VM dirty ratio. And one of them is set to 10% by default, and the second one is set to 20%. And it's controlled via sysctl, like on Linux, or maybe you can also do it via procfs. And it is set always per Linux machine, per kernel. There is not, it's not possible to set it per namespace like cgroup, unfortunately. And it would be good to have such possibility to do it per like Docker container or per pod. But unfortunately, it's not the case, and we have to do it per node. So, yeah, probably that was it. No more questions in the chat. I have nothing to add.
If there's no more questions, then that's it. Thank you very much. I appreciate you coming in.
Yeah. It was nice seeing you.
You too.
Bye.
Bye.